Hi all, this is Dr. Mamata Chava, Microbiology faculty, and in this video module, I'm going to talk about mucormycosis. Now guys, first and foremost, if I split this word mucormycosis into mucor plus mycosis, it's understandable that it's a fungal infection, that is mycosis, and this fungal infection is caused by a wide variety of filamentous fungi which have got aseptate or cenocytic hyphae, one example of which is mucor, and mucor belongs to the order Mucorales. Now, let us familiarize ourselves first with some basic properties and morphological features of this fungus. Now, on the screen, you can see something drawn in blue color, alright, and it is very broad and irregular looking with lot of blue dots. So, basically, these blue dots signify the nuclei, and as you can see, it's a filamentous structure with multiple nuclei. There are no septae at all. So, basically, what I've drawn over here is an example of an aseptate filamentous fungus or cenocytic fungus. Alright, now this fungus is very proud of the fact that just like God, it is omnipresent, it is everywhere. So, meaning to say, it's an environment. Saprophyte. It's present in the soil, in the air, the spores are prevalent in the air, all right, on decaying vegetation and all, right? So when it is everywhere, it is bound to infect humans and animals. But the good news is that if the immunity is good, then this fungus is harmless. Problem occurs when this fungus gets an opportunity in the form of some risk factor, in which case it can cause serious diseases, so much so that we can lose the patient if timely treatment is not done, right? So as I mentioned, this cartoon represents aseptate or cenocytic filamentous fungus, right? So appearance wise, we can describe these fungi as they are wide, meaning 6 to 30 or more microns is the width of these filamentous fungi. They are thick walled and they are irregular, broad, ribbon like with aseptate or cenocytic hyphae branching at right angles. Alright, so these fungi were earlier classified under the class Zygomycetes, and some of these infections were also believed to be caused by some members of Phycomycetes class, and that is why synonyms of mucormycosis used to be zygomycosis or phycomycosis. But guys, these terms are obsolete now. As per the latest classification, the infection caused by such fungi which have got aseptate morphology like this, it is referred to as mucormycosis, right? But still, the purpose of putting up Zygomycetes word in this slide is A to Z to be known about this fungus, because it's pretty important, right? So remember, A to Z, the first and last alphabets in English, A for aseptate hyphae and Z for Zygomycetes. Now, as per the latest classification, guys, we have got phylum Glomerulomycota, which has got two important subphyla, Mucormycotina and Entomophthoromycotina. Alright, and the diseases respectively caused by members in these subphyla are referred to as mucormycosis and entomophthoromycosis, also known as subcutaneous mucormycosis. Now, mucormycotina and entomophthoromycotina respectively have got some specific orders, that is, we have got order Mucorales and order Entomophthorales, right? So before going to the members, before going to the specific genera and the species which belong to these orders, let us also know entomophthoromycosis or subcutaneous mucormycosis involves which exact diseases. It involves two important diseases, remember B and C, basidiobolomycosis and conidiobolomycosis. All right. Now, finally, the order Mucorales, which I just mentioned, has got all these important, organisms. Like, most important is Rhizopus arhizus. It's most important because it is the most common fungus encountered in clinical specimen out in all the cases, in most of the cases of mucormycosis. And Rhizopus arhizus is also known as Rhizopus oryzae. Oryzae is the old name. O for oryzae and O for old. Then we have got Rhizopus microsporus, variety Rhizopodiformis, and then we have got genus Mucor, genus Rhizomucor, Apophysomyces, Cunninghamilla, Cocoromyces, Succinia species, Syncephalastrum, and Lichthenia, which is also known as Epsidia. Now, in this long list, at least remember Rhizopus arises, which as I mentioned is the most commonly encountered clinical pathogen from most of the cases of mucormycosis. Now, as far as the other order, that is Entomophthorales, is concerned, this list is quite simple. Just remember two important genera, Basidiobolus and Conidiobolus, which respectively cause Basidiobolomycosis and Conidiobolomycosis, right? So, mucormycosis basically is caused by these fungi. Now, there are some specific properties of these aseptate filamentous fungi. For instance, these fungi have got a tendency to run towards iron. Okay, so basically this cute fellow over here is nothing but iron, and we can see some love brewing over here between iron and this filamentous fungus. So basically iron is an important growth factor for these fungi, right? So now that we know that iron is so much important for these fungi, from what all sources can this fungus derive iron from? Now, iron can be obtained from all these sources. Remember DID, diabetic ketoacidosis, iron therapy, and desferrioxamine therapy. We know desferrioxamine is nothing but an iron chelator, and those people who have got overload of iron, like those who are repetitively receiving blood transfusions, like thalassemia patients, they are given, they are on desferrioxamine therapy because excess of iron is toxic to the tissues, right? Now, so far we know the classification, we know the morphology, that these are aseptate fungi, all right? And we know that diabetic ketoacidosis is such an important risk factor for mucormycosis. Now we are going to see why is that so. Guys, if this is a blood vessel, all right, DKA stands for diabetic ketoacidosis. Now, normally what happens, iron in the bloodstream is bound to, you know, proteins present in the serum, all right? In the setting of diabetic ketoacidosis, what happens? This iron dissociates from serum proteins, right? And this way it becomes available to the fungi. Then, what else is going to happen in the setting of DKA? There's going to be decreased pH of the serum, and because of this decreased pH of the serum, there's going to be, there are going to be important repercussions on the activities of the soldiers of our immune system, like neutrophils and macrophages, which are so important phagocytes. For instance, their phagocytic activity will be decreased, their chemotactic potential is going to be decreased, their oxidative burst is also going to be compromised. That is, they are not going to produce as many free radicals as normally they should. All right, so this is about the iron requirement by this fungus and what exactly is happening in diabetic ketoacidosis patients, which makes them so prone to mucormycosis, right? Now, a media generated fancy term is black fungus for mucormycosis. Now, is black fungus really black? What do you think? Now, black fungus is not there in the standard textbooks of mycology. Now, what I can decipher from this is, see, if somebody says black, what comes to my mind? I can think of maybe Sanjay Leela Bhansali's movie Black, or maybe the one with the blackout episode of Friends. All right, this fungus, these fungi, meaning the ones which cause mucormycosis, it is not exactly, you know, appropriate to refer to them as black fungi, because in mycology, the filamentous fungi, they can be classified into two categories: the hyaline fungi, which have got, you know, the hyaline hyphae or transparent hyphae, and the other category is pheoid fungi, which have got, you know, black filaments, right? So pheoid fungi cause a separate entity, a disease altogether, which is known as pheohyphomycosis or chromoblastomycosis, right? And not mucormycosis. Then why this phrase black fungus is used in the context of mucormycosis? Now let us see. The only thing which I can maybe decipher from mucormycosis being referred to as caused by black fungus is the property of this fungus to be angioinvasive, meaning it invades blood vessels, right? So here we can see a sick blood vessel. Basically, these fungi have got affinity or attachment or love to infect the elastic lamina of small and large arteries. All right. So for these kind of blood vessels, this fungus is literally a pain in the ass. And what is it going to cause? See, the immune system is not going to keep quiet when some invasion happens in the body. All right. So when this fungus tends to invade the blood vessels, there's going to be an inflammatory response, and there's going to be thrombosis, hemorrhage, necrosis, and infarction. All right. And because of this property of angio invasion, different different kinds of manifestations can occur in different tissues. So this is a very, very important property to be remembered regarding these fungi, that they're angio invasive. Now, so we have seen the angio invasive property just now of these fungi. Now, do we have some way out to protect ourselves from these fungi? Because invasion of blood vessels is something which is not good at all, and in many cases it can be even fatal, right? So if God gives us a problem, God gives us solutions also. For instance, in this case, we have got solution or jugaad in the form of two important soldiers of the immune system, the neutrophil and the this fellow is what, which is proudly flaunting the CD14 molecule on its head. This fellow is nothing but macrophage. Remember, CD14 is an important surface protein flaunted proudly by macrophages. So these two fellas are doing high five and conspiring with each other. Let's kick the ass of zygomycetes. All right. My point is, these two kind of cells or soldiers of the immune system, neutrophil and macrophage, these are important phagocytic cells, and we know how they are going to bring about, how they're going to deal with pathogens. And they are going to do phagocytosis, and then they are going to kill the pathogen by the contents of the phagolysosome or production of free radicals, there's going to be an increase in the oxygen consumption, which is known as oxidative burst. All right. So basically, via the oxidative or non-oxidative mechanisms, the phagocytes of our body, that is neutrophil and macrophages, are going to encounter or fight the pathogens, for instance, these kind of fungi. Now, out of these two soldiers, I have drawn some aura around neutrophils to emphasize upon the fact that neutrophils have got special fungicidal activity against zygomycetes, and that is why neutropenia or leukocytopenia is a very, very important risk factor for mucormycosis. Please remember that. So basically, whenever any quantitative or qualitative defect pertaining to phagocytes is going to happen, that itself is going to be a risk factor for these fungal infection. Okay, so we can easily decipher the risk factors in a nutshell, and they can easily be remembered by the mnemonic splint. Remember, steroids, especially systemic steroids, have got a dampening effect on the entire immune response. You read all of that in detail in pharmacology, and I would highly emphasize over here that after you finish watching this video, open your pharmacology textbooks and revise how steroids have got a dampening effect on the immune response. Then we have got protein calorie malnutrition or PCM, leukemia, immunodeficiency disorders, intravenous drug abusers, neutropenia, as I mentioned, and transplant, be it solid organ transplant or bone marrow transplant. All right. So basically, if I summarize in one line this slide, the point is, anything which jeopardizes the potential of the immune response, especially neutrophils or macrophages, is going to lead to an increased incidence of mucormycosis. Right. Now, a notable point in the context of intravenous drug abusers is that, now, intravenous drug abusers, they might happen to inject the spores of these fungi during the event of injecting the drug, and intravenous drug abusers usually present with space occupying lesions. Now, we saw a long list of the fungi belonging to the order Mucorales and Entomorph Thorales, right? And I mentioned there also that one name you should never forget, and that name is the most commonly encountered organism, that is Rhizopus arhizus, whose old name is Rhizopus oryzae. Right? Remember, O for old, O for oryzae. Now, Why should we give so much of attention to this organism Rhizopus arises? Now guys, see how cunning its face is. It's actually a problem. You know why? Why this fungus is all the more potent as compared to the other members of order Mucorales is because of these reasons. One is, of course, it is angioinvasive, just like, you know, it's all other brothers and sisters. Plus, it can grow at or above 37 degrees Celsius. Then it can elaborate many destructive enzymes which can harm the tissues. Then it has got dormant spores which can, you know, survive the highly acidic conditions in the body. And that is how, you know, even in the setting of diabetic ketoacidosis, this organism can easily survive and cause disease. Then it has got an active ketone reductase system which enables this organism to withstand the high high degree of glycemia and the high degree of acidosis in decay. Then it has also got hydroxamate siderophores. Remember, siderophore is a Greek term for iron carrier. I have already emphasized upon the fact that iron is so very special or important for these fungi. It's a very, very important growth factor. And because of possession of these siderophores, this organism Rhizopus arises. For it, it's a cakewalk, as far as stealing or getting iron is concerned. So because of all these reasons, Rhizopus arises becomes the most commonly encountered species in the clinical specimens of mucormycosis. Then, what about the modes of infection? Remember the three I's: inhalation of these spores, which is the most common, ingestion of these spores, or inoculation of these spores into the skin. Now over here, I would want you all to revise three I's within the context of, you know, three bacterial infections also, that is A, B and Q. Remember, A for anthrax, B for brucellosis and Q for Q fever. Now in all these three bacterial infections also, the three I's need to be remembered: inhalation, ingestion, inoculation of spores, or in case of brucellosis, inhalation of the dried up secretions from the animals, ingestion of the infected meat, or inoculation of the infected material from the animal as seen in vets or butchers, right? So these are the modes of infection. Now we have got different varieties of mucormycosis. For instance, the most dreaded and the most common disease entity is rhino-orbito-cerebral mucormycosis. Now obviously, as the name implies, it is going to happen, you know why? Because it is going to happen because of inhalation of these spores. So initially, what is going to happen? There's going to be involvement of the nose, paranasal sinuses, orbit, and eventually the brain if timely treatment is not commenced. Now the important risk factors in this case are DKA, that is diabetic ketoacidosis, and debilitating diseases like leukemia, lymphoma. Then usually the order of spread of infection in this disease is, it spreads from nasal mucosa to involve the turbinate bones, paranasal sinuses, orbit, palate, and finally brain, where extensive involvement of the blood vessels occurs, and eventually the patient develops frontal lobe necrosis and also multiple abscess formation. Now the involvement of bones can be ascertained by imaging techniques like CT and MRI. Now there could be a plethora of manifestations as far as rhino-orbito-cerebral mucormycosis is concerned. For instance, if we go clockwise in this diagram, the patient could be having a fresh onset of headache, or there could be drastic or blatant orbital involvement in the form of loss of vision, eye pain, conjunctival suffusion, proptosis. Right, there could be facial pain or numbness, or there could be frank black necrotic lesions involving the nose or even the palate, or there could be nasal or sinus congestion. There also could be involvement of cranial nerves, especially fifth nerve and seventh nerve. All right, and if nothing is done, the patient can die within 1 week of onset of disease. Okay, and also remember, if there is sudden onset of diplopia in diabetics for no obvious reason, then what you should think of? You should think of mucormycosis. Now guys, this is a picture showing the extensive necrotic area involving the nasal area and the facial area in this patient. All right, this is a picture showing you the involvement of the orbit, right? Then guys, The second most common type of zygomycosis or mucormycosis is the pulmonary type. All right. Now, surprisingly, this entity is usually not common in patients with DKA in contrast to ROCM, that is rhino-orbitocerebral mucormycosis. All right. Now, what happens in pulmonary zygomycosis? Of course, there's going to be involvement of the blood vessels. The fungus will show the property of invading the blood vessels. It is going to bring about then the necrosis and infarction of the involved tissue. And there can be a wide variety of manifestations in the lungs. Ranging from cavity formation, masses or consolidation, nodules or wedge-shaped infarct. And the involvement could be focal or diffuse, right? Now, chest X-ray may not pick up all these changes, and by far the best investigation in a suspected case of pulmonary zygomycosis is HRCT, on which reverse halo sign is seen. Now, the patient is going to present with cough, chest pain, dyspnea, fever may be present or it may be absent also at times. All right. Then very, very rarely, fungal ball can also be one of the manifestations, in which case it could be confused with aspergilloma. All right. Then hypersensitivity pneumonitis due to rhizopus has been reported in Scandinavian sawmill workers, the so-called wood trimmer's disease, and also in farm workers. Then the third kind of disease, we have got gastrointestinal mucormycosis, and the most common site is stomach. Okay. So we are seeing a sick stomach over here. And what do you expect the manifestation over here? The patient is obviously going to develop gastric ulcers. Remember, one basic property is angioinvasion. So irrespective of the site of involvement in the body, there's expect ulcerative lesions, necrotic lesions, infarction of the tissue. That is, if I want to summarize in a nutshell, what harm this fungus is going to cause to humans, it is necrosis and infarction. Now, stomach is the most commonly involved site in case of gastrointestinal disease. And remember, gastrointestinal mucormycosis is per se not that common. It comprises of just 7% of all cases of mucormycosis. And a very, very important risk factor is extreme malnutrition. Now, most of the cases have been seen in adults, but recently neonates have also been affected. And the mode of infection is ingestion of the food containing spores. For instance, fermented milk, porridge or alcohol made from corn or even herbal products, right? Now, apart from stomach, what other sites of the gastrointestinal tract can be involved? Remember, from bottom upwards, CIE, that is colon, ileum and esophagus. Now guys, the involvement of colon, it is usually seen in the setting of abdominal surgery in the event of a very filthy trauma to the abdomen, and involvement of ileum has been seen in the setting of contaminated ileostomy. Now, the signs and symptoms are very, very non-specific depending on the site involved and the extent of involvement, and they range from abdominal pain, diarrhea, hematemesis or melena. All right. Now, the fourth type of mucormycosis is isolated renal mucormycosis, where the kidneys are screwed. All right. Again, the pathophysiology remains the same, angioinvasion. There's going to be renal infarction, flank pain, fever, pyuria and hematuria. Now, sadly, these patients are believed to be suffering from acute bacterial pyelonephritis, and they are prescribed blindly antibiotics. But unfortunately, obviously, they're not going to respond because it is a fungal etiology. All right. And in the immunocompromised patient, acute pyelonephritis can develop. Now, the case fatality rate of isolated renal mucormycosis is 65%, which is still better than, other varieties of mucormycosis like ROCM or pulmonary mucormycosis. But if no treatment is done, the case fatality rate approaches 100%. Then we have got cutaneous mucormycosis, which could be primary or disseminated. Primary cutaneous mucormycosis is way more common, which occurs because of inoculation of the skin with the spores of the fungus, and that is expected to happen whenever the integrity of the skin is going to be jeopardized. Okay, for instance, primary cutaneous mucormycosis can happen in the setting of superficial ulcers in diabetics, gangrenous cellulitis in trauma patients, or contaminated elasticized wound dressings. All right. Now, as I said, a disseminated cutaneous mucormycosis is a very less encountered clinical entity. Now, as far as the clinical features of cutaneous mucormycosis are concerned, there can be a plethora of manifestations ranging from pustules, vesicles, necrotic wounds. All right. In the early stages, the lesions may mimic ecchyma gangrenosum, and there could be also appearance of what is known as hairy pus, which is nothing but the woolly appearance of the fungus over a wound. Now, the lesions obviously are painful because there's going to be involvement of the blood vessels, which in turn is going to lead to cutaneous infarcts. All right. And gradually the lesions can enlarge to become nodular ecchymotic areas as well. Now, necrotizing fasciitis can occur in the setting of cutaneous as well as subcutaneous mucormycosis, and it has got a very high case fatality rate. And also remember two important organisms amongst the order mucorales, that is lichthymia and succinia. They are more common agents of cutaneous mucormycosis in diabetic patients, and remember this as LSD. So lichthymia and succinia, they cause cutaneous mucormycosis more commonly in diabetic patients. Now, this is a pictorial representation of the cutaneous mucormycosis. You can very well appreciate the black necrotic lesion over here. All right. And this is how this fungus looks like. Now, we have so far discussed different varieties of mucormycosis, and very, very rarely there could be also what is known as disseminated mucormycosis, in which virtually any or every tissue of the body could be affected if timely treatment is not done. So now that we know the different types of mucormycosis, it's important to make a diagnosis on time and commence the treatment so as to save the patient. So depending on the type of mucormycosis, you can collect the sample. For instance, in case of ROCM, that is rhino-orbito-cerebral mucormycosis, the correct sample to be collected is either scraping on exudate from the nares, or hard palatal lesions or sinus material biopsy from the extracted tooth socket area. So basically, depending on what kind of involvement is there in case of ROCM, right? One can even go for endoscopic collection of the debrided tissue or biopsy, but do not collect dry nasal swabs. All right, that's an inappropriate specimen. Now, in case of pulmonary mucormycosis, do not go for saline washes of the mouth, that is saliva saline wash. Instead, go for either sputum or bronchial brush washings, or bronchoalveolar lavage, that is BAL, or you can go for lung biopsy or fluoroscope guided transthoracic needle aspiration or open lung biopsy. Then in GIT mucormycosis, do not collect feces, instead collect endoscopic biopsy of the lesions. And similarly in renal mucormycosis, contrary to the expected sample, that is urine, we go for biopsy of the lesions. Okay, then finally in cutaneous mucormycosis, what not to be collected is swab or material from open wounds, that is dry swabs. Instead, one should go for aspirate from undrained abscesses or pus expressed from the abscesses opened with a scalpel, and these should be transported to the lab in a sterile container or a syringe and needle. Or one can and also very, very importantly, the tissue should be collected both from the center as well as from the edge of the lesion. All right. So now that we have discussed about sample collection, a very, very important thing which is to be kept in mind if you are suspecting mucormycosis in a patient is, see, imagine now this is again a cartoonish pictorial representation of these fungi. These dots represent the multiple nuclei representing the cenocytic or aseptic hyphae. Now, what does this mean? Touch me not. Basically, these fungi are very, very delicate, broad, ribbon-like. So you should not be very, very harsh with the specimen. That is, do not unnecessarily grind or homogenize the tissue. Otherwise, the hyphae will break and you might not be able to appreciate the correct morphology under the microscope. All right. So this is very, very important point to be remembered while making a diagnosis. If you're suspecting mucormycosis, in the patient. Now, so you have collected the specimen, you are suspecting mucormycosis, so, and you have decided that you're not going to unnecessarily, you know, grind the specimen. So you go ahead with what? Microscopic examination. So for microscopic examination, what all you can do? You can go for KOH mount, periodic acid shift stain, or hematoxylin and eosin stain, Gomery methylamine silver stain, or Gram stain. Now, Gram stain I have written in the end because Gram stain is basically good for nothing stain. Gram stain is not going to always stain the fungal elements nicely. Remember, a general rule regarding fungi is all fungi are Gram positive, alright? But the filamentous fungi, they take up very faint blue color, so they can sometimes be missed on Gram stain. Instead, Gram stain is a very good diagnostic, is a very good staining technique if you're suspecting yeast or yeast-like fungi, fungal infections like Candida, Cryptococcus, okay? And out of all these stains, the best one is periodic acid shift stain, okay? GMS is also good enough. HNE is used for several other purposes also. It is not a special fungal stain, okay? So let us see some morphologies. Now this, guys, is the picture of mucor on Gomery methylamine silver stain. You can appreciate the irregular broad ribbon like hyphae. All right, then we have got the KOH mount where you can see these hyphae branching at right angles, aseptate they are. Then this is a picture of rhizopus in tissues stained with hematoxylin and eosin. Again, you can see the non-septate, you know, broad hyphae irregularly looking. Now, that's about the microscopic examination. Next, what can we do? We can do culture, okay? Now, all of us in our childhood must have had, must have relished this. What is this? Cotton candy. And this is how exactly the growth of these fungi looks like. So, it is described as floccose or cotton candy growth. All right, and specifically in case of rhizopus, we can see some black dots which represent the black spores, and which gives rise to the description of its appearance, that is salt and pepper appearance of rhizopus, as you can see in these pictures. Plus, because the growth is cottony, sometimes the lid of the petri dish is lifted, and that is why they are referred to also as lid lifters. So basically, the description lid lifters is because of the aerial growth. Okay, then of course we are talking about culture. These fungi, remember, they are not fussy. In other words, they are non-fastidious. They will happily grow on SDA, that is saprods, dextrose, agar. Okay, now once you get the growth, guys, you go ahead with another step to comment on the the specific kind of fungus, and that is LPCB mount, that is lactophenol cotton blue. Remember, LPCB mount or lactophenol cotton blue mount is never done directly with the specimen of the patient. You do it from the growth which you obtain on the culture media. Okay, the microscopic examination, irrespective of whatever stain you have used, it is just going to show you the morphology as broad, irregular, aseptate hyphae. It is not going to tell you whether it is mucor or rhizopus or epsidia or what. Okay, for doing that, you have to go ahead with culture. After you get some growth on the culture medium, then you have to go ahead with LPCB to finally comment on the specific type of fungus. For instance, over here on the left, you can see a schematic diagram of rhizopus. Rhizopus, as the name implies, it has got something, root-like structures called as rhizoids, which have marked over here. Alright, then of course you have cenocetic or aseptate hyphae. Right opposite the rhizoids, a stem-like structures arise which are known as sporangiophore. Basically, phore, that is P-H-O-R-E-4, refers to stalk or stem, and sporangiophore means a stalk or stem at the top of which is present a structure called as sporangium, and the sporangium or spherical structure is filled with these light blue colored structures called as sporangiospores, which are an example of asexual spores. Okay, so this is one example of asexual spores in mycology, which is encountered in zygomycetes or fungi belonging to the order Mucorales, right? So this is a schematic representation, and on the right, the actual LPCB mount you can see, where you can appreciate the rhizoids over here, all right? And this is the sporangium filled with sporangiospores. Then we have got what? Then we have got mucor. Now, in case of mucor, as on the left-hand side of the screen, you can see a schematic representation of mucor. Mucor does not have rhizoids at all, unlike rhizopus. Okay, but obviously it is going to have cenocytic or aseptic hyphae. It has got sporangiophore, that is the stalk at the top of which sporangium is present, which again is going to harbor what? The asexual spores called as sporangiospores. And on the right, you see an LPCB mound of mucor, all right, devoid of rhizoids. Right, so now that I have commented that sporangiospores are an example of asexual spores in mycology, now guys, also important, another important fact to be remembered about these fungi is that they also produce sexual spores known as zygospores and oospores. Okay, now in the entire mycology, there are only four examples of sexual spores, that is zygospores and oospores, which are encountered in these fungi. Then we have got ascospores, right, which are produced by fungi belonging to the class Ascomycetes. Please don't confuse it with arthrospores or arthroconidia. Remember, ascospores have got S in their name, S for sexual. So ascospores are sexual spores. Arthrospores or arthroconidia are asexual spores. All right, so zygospores, I said, oospores, ascospores, and the fourth and the last one is basidiospores, which are an example of sexual spores encountered in another fungal class, that is Basidiomycetes. So remember ZOAB, zobe, to remember the only four sexual spores in the entire mycology. Other than these names, no matter whatever is the name of the spore, that spore is going to be an example of asexual spore. For instance, in this case, sporangiospores. All right. Now, finally, guys, treatment. Because the case fatality rate of mucormycosis is very high, approaching 50-60%, right? And you can easily lose the patient if timely treatment is not done. So it's very, very important to make a correct diagnosis and commence treatment right away. And the mainstay of treatment is surgical debridement. Debride all the dead necrotic tissue. Now this should take upper hand even before the initiation of antifungals. And as far as antifungals are concerned, the drug of choice is amphotericin B, guys. And amongst azoles, in general, azoles are not that effective other than posaconazole and isavuconazole. Now, as far as posaconazole is concerned, a noteworthy point is that if you start posaconazole, it is going to take around a fortnight to show its effect. And during this window period, you should cover the patient with amphotericin B. All right. Then cytokines in experimental, as experimental therapy have been tried. For instance, interferon gamma and GM-CSF, that is granulocyte monocyte colony stimulating factor. All right. So guys, this is about mucormycosis. I hope you like the video and let me know in the comment section what you feel about it. Thank you. Study well. God bless.